We're running strong campaigns in places where no one would have ever expected to see a Green Party lawn sign, so I'm excited.
Well, the green wave once threatened to become a political tsunami at the beginning of the election campaign, swamping the NDP, went the narrative. But has it all been a false alarm? How much can the Greens actually grow? All parties are watching BC, where there are four-way splits all over the place in different ridings. Could that province finally decide who's the next government? And what should you be watching for? Let's bring back the Scrum to find out. Laura Stone is back. Craig Oliver is back. Richard Madden is back. Our special guest for this round is BC Green Party leader Andrew Weaver. He joins us from Victoria. He also happens to hold the balance of power, and we'll get into that. Mr. Weaver, let me just start with you, and I just want to say on behalf of all of us, we know you've had a health scare, and you're going to eventually pass the torch to a new leader. We're glad to see you back on the program and healthy, but give us your sense of what you're seeing in British Columbia, especially or across the country for the Green Party.
Well, I have a lot of information and feel quite comfortable in commenting on Vancouver Island, where it's no longer an oddity to vote Green. I wouldn't be surprised to see the Greens pick up quite a number of seats in this area. Look, there's a very strong candidate, David Murner, who ran for the federal Liberals, running against Randall Garrison. Russell Coy is running against Laurel Collins, a city councillor who, after only 3 months in council, decided she was going to jump the ship and run federally. And so there's a lot of backlash against that. You can see also by the NDP ground game here. Clearly, it's being run out of Ottawa and not realizing how people in this southern Vancouver Island react. It's a very negative campaign, and people react against that. If you look at the signs, if signs matter, the Greens are basically won all the signs from Cowichan Valley South and also in Nanaimo. So I wouldn't be surprised to see a number of seats picked up here at the expense of the NDP.
And I think you do have to wonder about whether or not the Liberals can hang on to everything they've had there in the past. They paid a very high price for a high-priced pipeline that alienated an awful lot of environmentalists in that province. But not only that, I mean, SNC-Lavalin, as we all know, had special relevance in British Columbia. I think the Liberals may lose some seats there.
And you wonder about the Green. How is Elizabeth May? She had a big wave at the beginning and seems to have overtaken a bit by Jagmeet Singh.
Yeah,
Laura.
I think Elizabeth May has struggled somewhat under the scrutiny of a major campaign. This is the big leagues now. And she has struggled, I think, in some circumstances to get her message across. I mean, at one point in the campaign, she was talking about Quebec sovereignty. You know, she's kind of been off the map. I think if they had stuck to their main primary issue, which has always been climate change, they may have had a better shot at sweeping the NDP as the progressive alternative. But we've seen her and the party kind of go all over the map, and I'm not sure that that has resonated in the way that they'd hoped for.
The way the Green Party is constructed, it seemed to have a great deal of difficulty turning itself into a national party, a national movement. They really grew up as provincial entities, and it's been, I think, pretty much impossible for Elizabeth to build a national campaign, at least this time.
Laura, that may not be critical. If Andrew Weaver's right and they pick up 3-4 seats on the island, they've got 2 right now, they got a 4 or 5, heck, if we're in a minority position, Elizabeth may play a role as a balance of power. Is that enough to call it a successful campaign for the Greens?
I think so. I mean, first, let's appreciate the sentence, balance of responsibility. I really like that. I think certainly in a minority situation, we don't know how many seats the NDP are going to pick up, if they're even going to retain what they have. They're going to struggle in Quebec. We know that. So, yes, I think if Elizabeth May is able to even pick up a handful of seats, you know, she could have influence, especially if the Liberals or if the Conservatives form the minority and they need their support. They could have a lot of influence on the government. The question is, you know, in a Conservative minority, who could actually support that party? Could Elizabeth May support an Andrew Scheer government?
The question, and if it's and Rich, if it's a minority Liberal government and the NDP and the Greens may have a balance of power, do they squeeze Justin Trudeau on the Trans Mountain pipeline? That becomes a big issue.
It's not just pipelines. The fact of anything really getting done of great national importance really becomes a challenge if you have the Greens, you have the NDP, and the Liberals all fighting for that same spectrum on that progressive side.
There's also a question about whether Elizabeth May will be around to lead the party any further. Remember, last time she wanted to quit, felt she couldn't find anybody she was satisfied with to lead the party. She said a number of times she's tried to find people. the suggestion is she won't stay beyond this campaign for very long.
As the leader, although she says she'll stay on.
Yeah.
Andrew Weaver, look, all over Canada, there's this boogeyman of coalitions, which are pretty rare, or arrangements. Who holds the balance of power? You're in it. You guys are in the balance of responsibility, the balance of power, whatever term you want. What do you make of all this fear-mongering about minority governments and who's got the seats and who can control the government?
Well, I think you'll see, if you look to British Columbia, it's now been 2.5 years, well, almost 3 years. This minority will go the full length. We have a very respectful, good working relationship. John Horgan and I have become quite good friends. And you know, honestly, I think it's better governance. I think if you talk to Mr. Horgan, our premier, he would say that their governance is better because we're there. And I would argue that, you know, we've played a tempering role in some of the more, dramatic policies, for example, that, you know, often people get elected based on a base supporting you, and some of those policies are perhaps not really palatable to broader constituents. And in fact, so we've been able to temper some of those, and it's worked really well. So I think we're modeling the success. And frankly, I think it's irresponsible for people to say prior to the election result they're not willing to work with anybody, because you know you are elected to work with everybody, and if you're taking the position that you should not work with somebody, then really you shouldn't be running, because that is why we're elected, to represent the constituents and work with whoever is in the parliament.
All right, I'll leave this last word to Craig Oliver, who's a BC boy. Does BC finally get a chance to decide this election? Craig, are we in it for a late night?
I don't think so. I think there's growing support for the Liberal Party. They have probably a decent chance of getting a solid minority. But we'll find out. I might be wrong.
Gosh.
I doubt it. I wish it.
I don't know.
It frustrates British Columbians.
All right, got to leave it there. Green Party leader Andrew Weaver, appreciate you joining us. And Richard Madden, thanks so much as well. And Rich, we'll see you back here on this set on Monday night on the election special.